The cream of the crop, that is correct. These guests are always introduced to you on the sets of Who's Who. This well-admired segment is founded here by Mr. Sonny Siegel, who is the CIO of Montgomery County in Maryland. Who is his guest today? Let's find out together.
Welcome to the Who's Who Show. I'm your host, Sonny Siegel. Today, our guest is a well-known entrepreneur, media personality, movie producer, and motivational speaker. Many of us have seen her on TV and in published media the world over. She's none other than Monika Samtani. Welcome,
hello.
Monika.
Thank you, Sonny. Thank you
for
having
show.
Me.
Appreciate it's such an it. Honor to have you on the
Thank
show.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here.
Monika, you have so many accomplishments, and you're so varied, you know, in your achievements. Our audience is anxious, I'm sure, to hear about them, having seen you so often and read about you. So at a very early time in Washington, D.C. history, you were a successful media market mogul. Right? You broke into that market?
I did. I broke into the market here in Washington.
Yes. And can you tell us, can you share with us how you started your career in media?
I would be happy to. Thank you so much for asking. Well, the story goes all the way back to when I was born. I like to say I was born knowing what I wanted to do. I was always a performer. And then in college, actually, Indian TV was new on cable. And so when I was 17, I started hosting an Indian TV show. My mother, didn't even actually have my license at 17. My mother would drive me to the studio because I insisted that that's what I wanted to do, so I would anchor the news. So it really started back in the 80s, believe it or not. From there, I actually moved to England and had my own overnight show on the radio at Essex Radio in Breeze AM in Southend.
In Essex.
In Essex, yes, in England. So I was lucky because I was literally fresh out of college and got a gig there. And then during the week I would produce, but this was an overnight show on the weekends. And I took it. I was 21 years old and I took it. Then it ends up that I had to move back here. So I had to get a start again. But luckily I had...
Here being to the U.S.
Back to the U.S., back to Washington.
Into Washington,
yeah, back to
DC
home.
Area.
This
I
is
see.
Home. And I'm one of the few natives of Washington, D.C. But I did live in London and outside of London for that time period for about 2 years. So when I came back, I said, all right, well, I've got to start over. Well, I was very lucky because I got to do radio on Mix 107.3, WMAL.
Yes, very but familiar station.
Again, I was young. Hardin and Weaver were on at that time. I mean, they were the icons in the industry at the time. Our generation now wouldn't even know them, but Jack Diamond was there, and he's still
yes,
on the air now,
big
so
names.
I worked with him. But basically, I got to do a little bit of, you know, producing and a little bit of odds and ends because you're breaking in. Mm-hmm. But then I got to do overnight gigs, as we call it again, on the radio there, worked my way up through radio, and finally, in the 90s, I got a job on Channel 9, WSA 9, and I stayed there from, I'm going to say, 1997 until 2014. So
wow,
off and on. That's
and,
where
and
I grew up.
That's when we saw you.
That's
as
where
anchor.
I think.
And that's USA Today, or affiliate, is it? Or not? WUSA?
Well, it's a Tegna station now.
Okay.
So WSA 9 is wow. a CBS affiliate station
oh,
in
CBS
Washington, D.C. Yes.
I see.
So really, that's where
and
I'm going to say.
That's associated with the networks. I mean, the.
Well, it's the
big
CBS
networks.
Station
yes.
in D.C. Mm-hmm. So really, I would say that that's where I grew up. That's where I found my mentors. That's where I did then. I was on the morning news at the desk with the big names, including Andrea Rohn, Frank Herzog at the time. Mm-hmm. He was there. Topper Schutt, who's still there.
Yes,
and
Topper's
many other
back.
Big names. Hillary Howard was there on the air with me, and now she's the main anchor on WTOP. So I was really there, I like to say, at a time when it was those big icons, the ones who stayed and really knew the news, and some of those big names are still there today. Even Bruce Johnson is still there at Channel 9. So I was really lucky to learn from the best, I would say.
So you essentially accepted whatever assignments they had, for instance, you know, filling in,
oh, absolutely.
doing the overnighters.
Yeah, you know, yes. I'm one of those old school ones because in that day, you did everything behind the scenes to learn what it took to be in front. Hmm. Like, I'm sitting with you here today, and that's basically what I did, is sit at the desk and do these interviews. But I knew what was going on behind the scenes because I had done it. So today, you know, with social media, there's so many roving reporters who consider themselves reporters and anchors, and oftentimes, sure, they're doing a great job.
Stand-up journalism, backpack journalism.
But immediately you can be that reporter. Well, whereas in my day, it was harder. It was harder to break in. And also in my day, there was no one like me in terms of, let's say, just the idea of my culture, my color. There was no one like me to help me open those doors. So I had to figure it out myself. And so I feel like today there are a lot more familiar faces to us on TV, such as Dr. Sanjay Gupta, such as other news anchors, and now, of course, the big names like Priyanka Chopra on Quantico.
Yes, we'll talk about that some more.
I think that at that time it was more difficult, and but I persevered. And I made it through, and I stayed on, and I was on the morning news for the most part on Channel 9 up until 2014 when I started my business.
Very, very good. Yeah, well, let's talk some more about that. So, and what exciting things are you doing in media at the present time?
So I started my own company, Ms. Media, and Ms. is actually my initials, Monika Samtani, but I didn't want to call it MS, so it's Ms. Media. And what I'm enjoying most about that is being that entrepreneur. I've leveraged what I learned for over 25 plus years in the professional media business. This is the number 7 market in the country. Mm-hmm. So I've learned everything I needed in order to run a media company. So we do basically 4 verticals. It's PR in the traditional sense, meaning placement in radio, TV, and print, but also in the digital world. So that's the new media stuff. So PR, video production, social media, content management and strategy, and also executive coaching and media training.
I see.
So that's what we do. It's very exciting. And I find it even more exciting to lead a group of very talented individuals who have energy and great ideas that we bring to our team. And I think that's fantastic.
Does it make for a very long, very intense day? Because you have your customers, your clients' success at heart.
Is my success.
Yeah.
The customer success is my success. So one of the big lessons that you learn as an entrepreneur is that you are always working. You are always working 24/7.
This is not a 9-to-5.
Never a 9-to-5. Then you shouldn't be in that business. You should work at a 9-to-5 job, and that's fine too, but not in this case. So, but I would like to say that going back to my experience working all hours of the night and day in the media taught me to be okay with doing this as well, because that's what it takes. We're gonna do what it takes. And I think also the other exciting part about it is the clients. You know, we really take the time to understand the client, and then we get so involved that it's really exciting to see them grow and succeed. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun.
To that, I noticed that your international media management and public relations company, Ms. Media, has a wide variety of clients, and in fact, they are international. You know, some of the names that I have in front of me are the World Bank, Wipro, which is a giant technology company, then the globally known film Girl Rising, and the feature film Sold, which was, I think, very recently there. Can you share with us your thoughts about how you approach this diversity of clients?
Well, you know, yes, each client is different, but the thing is, when you look at each client, you first look at what is their goal? What is it that they do? What's their business model? What is it that they hope to achieve through us? And then you formulate a comprehensive strategy to help them reach that goal and to achieve success. So each client that you look at, you really have to look at them independently. You may be able to help them because of experience that you've had with another client, like Girl Rising and Sold. Very different films, but ultimately it's about empowering girls and women. Mm-hmm. So you know that that's sort of the same platform, and you learn from each experience and bring it to the next client. So, But each client's going to be different in terms of their needs, and so we look at that. We're sort of a boutique firm in that way. We take the time to understand what each client needs and then fulfill that goal.
So is there a lot of discussion in the front end, trying to understand their business mission? And then bringing the creativity to it?
Absolutely.
I see.
Because
it's not like a very scripted statement of work.
No, absolutely, it cannot be. And the thing is that with the services that we provide, they may only want one of those services, they may want all of them, or they may even want something more than that. So we're gonna approach each one individually and independently.
I see. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's most interesting. I've never been anything other than an admirer, you know, folks who are in the media business.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
It's a great business, yeah.
Now, I've heard you speak at numerous events, and the importance of the female entrepreneur. And I think you emphasize that, and you emphasize the education around women empowerment through education. Are you able to share with us some of the ways you're promoting this very commitment that you have?
I'm very dedicated to women's empowerment, and I think a lot about it on a personal level. I think I was lucky because although I went in the non-traditional career growing up, I was lucky that I had support, right? So I think it's important for us to look at women's empowerment and girls' empowerment on a large scale. So where does it start from? It starts from education, and it starts from opportunity. Mm-hmm. So one of the lucky breaks that I had when I first started my business in 2014 was my first client. It just, you know, you feel so excited when you get that first email or that first call. You never know where it's gonna come from. And it happened to be Sahasra Deepika, School for Girls, which is based in Bangalore, but it's run by a Virginia family. So she used to watch me on TV, noticed I wasn't there, and gave me a call. Said, what are you doing? I need your help. So I'm still working with them today. And what I love is that they take girls from abject poverty and give them that opportunity not only for top-notch education, but to come out of it ultimately with a job, to stand on their own two feet and be empowered financially. Because the only way you're going to be independent is to have financial independence, right? Whether that's in Bangalore or whether that's here. So another client that I work with in terms of female empowerment is an initiative called Her Wealth. I started working with them last summer, and we already are on WTOP radio once a week with our own segment on Her Wealth. The client speaks every week about financial confidence for women, opening that conversation, because so many women, not all, but so many, are guilty of not bringing the idea of money into their lives, not having that conversation with their partner, not understanding where are they invested. And then, ultimately, unfortunately, a lot of times what can happen is that you're in a situation unexpected.
Yes,
what if your partner or your spouse passes away and you don't know where the money is?
Parents,
what if you get a divorce?
Yeah,
what if it's illness, parents, anything? Anything can happen. Why are we not part of that conversation? So there's a million topics around that we bring to WTOP once a week. Mm-hmm. And we also were just spotlighted on NASDAQ's Facebook Live in Times Square with what we're doing. What I'm most excited about now, though, is that even Ms. Media is bringing a new storytelling campaign around women's empowerment of our own. So it's going to be a multi-generational approach to storytelling about what women are doing and give them a platform to inspire, to promote each other, and to create change.
And you'll have real life testimonials and
stories?
Yeah,
so I won't give you all the news. It's going to launch very, very soon.
Our audience will understand.
Yes, and we'll be able to watch that on our website, Ms. Media, msmedia.tv, very soon. Yeah.
Now you have been on TED Talks, which is a highly touted speaker series, you know, on business science and everything else. And you have a very strong message there. I have to encourage our listeners, you know, to visit TED Talks and see your video there. We're practically out of time, and so we'll have to have you back on the show. Your movie as well, right? The PBS series, Hinduism in America, is another thing, of course, people should watch. And we should look out for you when you're in the company of people like Priyanka Chopra, Freya Pinto, actress Gillian Anderson. So with that, can we say just bye-bye for now?
Of course.
And hope to be on the show again.
Absolutely.
Soon.
My pleasure. Thank you so much, Sunny, for being here today. My pleasure.
This is your host, Sunny Siegel, signing off on the Who's Who Show. Please join me next month at the same place and the same time.